Okay, sir, you can go.
Ready?
Yes.
This is the regular session of the Civil Service Commission held on Monday, January 28th, 5:30 p.m. Cochise County Board of Supervisors hearing room located at 1415 Melvin Lane, Building G. Roll call. Commission members, Kent Budge, I'm here. Nancy Jacobson.
Present.
Kathy Wright.
Here.
And Daniel Deshawn is our staff liaison. And Joni Giacomino, council liaison, is here. First order of business, there's nobody here to speak to call the public. We'll let that ride. And so we need approval of the minutes for October 22nd of the regular session of the Civil Service Commission. Do I have a motion?
I motion to approve the minutes of from October 22nd, 2018 regular session of the Civil Service Commission.
I'll second that. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. We already dispensed with call of the public. So tonight we're here to go over quite a few different rules and recommendations to the personal rules and regulations. So we will forward quickly, I'm hoping, through most of these. If anybody has any questions, be sure to bring those up. So, I guess we'll let you take off with it and we'll interrupt when we need to.
Good evening, thank you. So we have about 12 policy amendments, A through H, this commission has seen before. I through L are new. A little background, I did take all of them, A through L, to the employee council, received some feedback, made some changes, and I think it was the second presenting to them that they did make. They voted and made a recommendation to council for approval of these. And the policies that you have, there have been some changes. I have the notes from the last time we met. So what you have is kind of the third iteration after the employee council. So this has all of their recommendations. And my goal tonight is to hopefully, if you guys feel comfortable, to make any recommended changes. And we can notate that, and we can make changes on the computer, and get the policies to the level that you're comfortable in making the recommendation to have. Okay. So I do have the notes. I don't know how you'd like to go through this. We can go over them one by one. We can talk about the changes you recommended last time. I can talk about the changes the employee council made. Or if you have specific questions, we can start with those. Or I could read them one by one.
Well, I think we should just take it by the I through L, or A through L, and just if there's changes we haven't seen, we could bring those up, then that would be something you would want to look at. As I perused them, I noticed several things, but I don't always have the best memory of what we did last time, that many months ago.
Okay, I can go through them and point out the changes that have been made along the way since the last time you've seen it.
Right. So section one, the definition page.
Yes, I put those in a paired order for better understanding. So for example, I have exempt, non-exempt, part-time, full-time, benefits eligible, non-benefits, classified, unclassified. So they're easy to understand, but ultimately when they go in the manual, they'll be all better. The only change in here from last time was I had to adjust classified employee definition. It had some language in there about contractors, but at no point should a contractor be an employee, so I didn't want that language in there.
I do have one question when I went over these. Under B, which is a benefit eligible and a non-benefit eligible employee.
Yes.
It says work sufficient hours. To me, that's ambiguous to the employee. Shouldn't we put a certain number of hours in there, like 40?
I don't know. Did I send you guys the memo that said how benefits are broken down? For example, ASRS, which is state law, is 20 hours a week, but PSPRS, which is also state law, is 40 hours a week. And every benefit has a different threshold of hours. For example, our health insurance, dental, and vision, through federal law, it's on average 30 hours. But life insurance and short-term disability through our contract with Mutual of is 40 hours. So each one has a different threshold of one of the clients.
So isn't there a way we can reference that chart somehow? So that how would the employee know to go to that section that defines all that?
You know, when they in process, I give them offer letter and says you're working this many hours, so you're going to be a 0.5 FTE and you get these benefits. That chart is just a memo I put together.
Okay, so it's not, because it's not part of the actual rules and regulations.
Correct. In the rules and regulations, when it gets to benefits, I don't have the whole thing with me, but it says that that section about benefits is changed, the HR director can change that to reflect the current benefits. And I did try to bring that mandated by state or federal law.
But some of them aren't.
Correct.
It's by our contract with the county.
There's a couple that are by the contract. Right. The contract. So and with the provider.
I'm just trying to make it as clear as possible for the, you know, they first come in, they're overwhelmed, they know that, and then they want to go back and refer to our personnel policies. If there's a way that, you know, I don't know. I have like four things to talk about. That was just one of them. How do they know down the road? A year later that also now they have a problem come up and then they try to go back in and says, well, sufficient, what does that mean? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I guess they can come, I guess.
In the PAFs, when we hire a full-time employee, I use the language entitled to all benefits, entitled to full-time employment. And if you look at the way we do employees, it's either a 0.5 employee, which is no benefits, or 1.0 full-time, which is all benefits. And I think there's only one or two employees that are in between that, at like a 0.75 level. And I mean, I meet with them and say, okay, you get this, and that's enough.
Okay. Just wanted to clear that up. It's usually, it's, you know, dead a lot of it's 40 hours. Just interrupt anytime anybody has a question.
So I'll just keep going.
See you and recognize you.
I'll just keep going through and talk about my notes that I've made to either employee counsel or.
Right.
So that was the definition.
The temporary hire, I had a question on that.
Yes.
Why is it not to exceed 6 months?
So it doesn't get abused. Like the temporary hire, because the way the clause is written, you can forego the summons and normal hiring procedures, like you would have to interview, or you would have to post or advertise. So it's easier to get a person on, you shouldn't be able to become a regular employee. So for example, with dispatch, we do this a lot with dispatch, unfortunately. We'll need to post a position for dispatching in 2 weeks, posting minimum per manuals, scheduling interviews, background check, and then the training for dispatch, that's another 6 to 8 weeks. You're looking at 3 months from when someone gives a 2 weeks notice. But with a temporary hire, we can hire someone and say, okay, you're hired, we didn't, for example, you may already be qualified as a dispatcher. So we're not going to wait for the position to be posted for 2 weeks per man. Or we need someone here to qualify, and you know, we can do the initial records check and get you. But if you want to be a full-time, or if you want to be a regular employee, you need to go through that process. You can't circumvent it.
Okay.
If you circumvent it, it puts a limit on that for 6 months.
Thank you.
Pardon me on the order here, they're a little different from employee counsel. So I'm going to go through as best I can. Internal hires, I didn't have any objections to that one. That just gives us the option to do an internal recruitment, which is still competitive with the approval of the city manager.
What section is that?
That was section, it was chapter 3, section 1. So that's chapter 3, section 1.
Yeah.
That's basis for appointment.
Yeah, it works a lot better if we could go down the rules and regulations. But.
Oh, would you want me to follow the list on the on here?
Yeah, because that's kind of the way it's set up.
All right, so I will follow this.
If you can do that, it would be easier than us to force.
Okay, so you did definitions. We'll go hiring contingencies, which is chapter 3, section 5. Last time, Ken, you asked that I added the fire department, which was, I missed that, so we added those classifications. I removed the clause about recurrent background checks.
Yeah, that was something we had talked about. Yeah.
So
I
that's...
Does the criminal justice background check include their financial background?
No.
It doesn't. No. Well, why don't we do that if we have people with financial hands places?
You know, it's kind of different schools of thought. If someone has bad credit, can they not work in finance? Or with the criminal, if someone's stolen or committed a fraud, then I would say they can't. There's a lot of different rules with the Fair Credit Reporting Agency, and my opinion is with the criminal check, I feel that's
And then one other thing is, about city council people, council members,
you know,
do they get a background check?
No. I mean, for example, the sheriff, he's elected, and Arizona Post gives him an automatic police officer.
Yeah, that works out sometimes. You've got some sheriffs in trouble. Okay.
The only thing we do for city council members, and this was because they're compensated, we have to make sure they're eligible to work in the United States Visa, which we also have to do to be on the ballot. But
they also have to file a financial disclosure statement.
Okay.
So that's probably greater your financial situation.
I think the way I printed it.
Oh, I'm just organizing it. Yeah.
Okay. And that's, they're not in the American order, so it's my fault. So was there any other feedback about the contingencies? Next is the hiring policies, which is Chapter 3, Section 4, it's evaluation of applicants. And last time we met, you guys, I don't think you liked this one, so I took another stab at it. So with this one, my desire for this, you can see that I've condensed it down a little bit, so instead of saying peer reviews or examination, I just say assessment. fire candidate, that could be your PT test, your written test, your interview, then your physical, then your, that's all. So I don't want to itemize those now. And then it still maintains language that candidates will be provided substantially the same opportunity so that we don't change the standards for the test. If we're hiring for police officer, here's the pass fail for everybody. So there's no favoritism in there. And the language I removed in there, it says redundant. It says, for example, for personnel director showing the fifth evaluation documents. But there's directors here that I work with. I say, okay, would you like to make the first review? It doesn't have to be me. You know, personnel director shall forward the qualifying applications. And it's a little excessive. We're working on hiring an accounting coach. I said, Carrie, would you like to do the first review?
And not always you. It's been a long time here. We didn't have a personnel director.
Yeah.
So.
And then it says, you know, the include explanation of the skills which should be demonstrated, blah, blah, blah. But it's sensible that it's the same thing. They'll be examined and reviewed for a demonstration of merit and fitness for the position. In the other language, so the applicant may need to make his own arrangements in order to be physically present. So it's the same thing. The city will not generally provide reimbursement for costs to attend any year. So that, in the sentence, it says the same thing twice.
Is there somewhere you have, I'm on, let's see, where the page starts out, A, the personal director was struck out. That B section, to me, the wording there, with all the strikeouts, it's like, okay, I've kind of highlighted the words that are still in there. Maybe I'm not reading it right, or, okay, it says, prior to any of the applicants, the department head shall prepare an outline of the manner in which the qualifying applicant will be examined and reviewed for a demonstration of their merit and fitness. That's fine. Then down after everything struck out there, it's like, no, will be scheduled until personal director has approved it.
So if you go back one, Chief, that in the policies, so I have like a request cover page.
Okay.
And then the next page is, it has the black and red text. That is what I like, or what I'm proposing the policy to be.
Okay.
And the red text is new.
I understand.
And the next page shows everything that's been removed. So there's no, I'm not trying to sneak anything down to you. So I'm saying what's new and then what's been removed.
Oh, okay.
So the new policy is the one with no strikeout.
No strikeouts, just the red.
Okay,
I mean,
and
that makes better sense
to see that.
Okay.
Because I want to be able to say if this, you guys know what we're moving.
Okay.
There's two sides to that.
Okay.
Which we already looked at. Any other questions on the hiring policy? Evaluation?
So is it advertisement or are positions available internally and externally at the same time?
Right now, we're not allowed to do internal only hires.
Okay.
So everything is up to the public.
Okay. So anybody that works for the company would have to read it in the paper and
yes.
Come in.
And I try to email it out to all employees as well. And small city, so everybody usually knows what's hiring. It's my website and Facebook. Mm-hmm. But I think what really, the reason I'm trying to change this is when people that have been working in the interim position for a while, mm-hmm. I have to go and post that to the paper, and they have to compete with the public. And I don't think that's fair, especially in our public safety. So we give lieutenant, deputy chief promotions, and I have to go put that in the paper and say, okay, you guys have been doing this for a year, but now you have to compete. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Are you guys happy with the hiring policy?
Internal.
And then the next one would be the internal hires. So now we're going in order. So your documents match the agenda. So then this will allow us to do internal hires so we can post the job. It's still going to be competitive, but we can say, okay, anybody internal that wants to apply.
Can it has to be approved by the city manager?
Yes, I don't want this to be abused hours. I wish it'd be an extra love.
Yep. Oversight. Jump on that.
Next one is the light duty and return to work.
Probation.
Light duty and return to work are switched.
I'm not seeing light duty.
It's right after probation. So the order is perfect.
Not yet.
Chapter 5.
And from my notes,
it's chapter 5, section 2.
And we're in compliance with all the HIPAA rules that we would never disclose why a person.
Yes.
Okay.
So, Ken, from my notes last time, you guys did not want the employees' past performance and contributions to the department to be considered in light duty assignments, so I've removed that. And the one thing that I didn't take out is I kept the term in there dismissal. So that's me from the HR side saying at a certain point there has to be dismissal if you never return to work. But we can try to transfer, and I recall you saying in my notes that you didn't know if that was appropriate. So if you guys want it one way or another, we can show you the recommendation. Chapter 5, section 2, be determined for 12.
It's not in there. It's okay. It was up here. I put it in order. All right.
I do have a question, though. What if somebody is given medical marijuana?
The city actually already has a policy on that.
Okay.
And it states that if you have a prescription for your medical marijuana and it's legal, that's okay. Mm-hmm. As long as it's outside of work. I don't have the whole policy manual in front of me, but it says it has to be outside of work. Okay. You can't, take your medicine on lunch break. work or before work, it has to be completely separate. You know, we're still a drug-free workplace.
Okay.
And there's language in there as well. For example, if you have to take your analysis and you test positive for marijuana.
Okay.
For example, let's say a vehicle accident. You use your medicine on the weekend, and you know, weeks later you get in a vehicle accident, so you get the mandatory testing. Remember, this is not for our the federal, like the bus drivers, those guys, it's no. But if it's internal, not a commercial vehicle, not a commercial driver's license vehicle, not passenger carrying, just one of our vehicles, there is a clause that if there is no reasonable suspicion that marijuana, drugs, or alcohol were a cause of the accident, you can, for lack of a better term, you can pop in.
Okay.
As long as the responding officer doesn't say, hey, smoke marijuana.
Right. But what if light duty included somebody that was a driver and they came in, and now they have to operate a type of a machine or something?
I'm not following that.
Okay, so they use medical marijuana, which is fine. They have the prescription. They can't drive a vehicle, is what I understand what you're saying, when they come back to work.
From light duty?
From duty?
Are you talking about light duty or right. Medical marijuana?
Light duty. If they were doing something heavier than that, and you assign them to be like the errand guy or something, light duty.
Oh, okay. It depends on the restrictions from their doctors.
Okay.
So we would, what we do is we, like for your initial physical, give the job description.
Okay.
So if you're on light duty,
okay.
The doctor would give us something that says the person can, you know,
I see, that they actually describe what the person is available
yeah.
to do.
Yes, absolutely. So if
gotcha.
It's no driving,
okay.
We go by what the doctor says.
Okay.
I don't know if this is the appropriate.
I'm sorry, I thought that was light duty.
Well, what happens if you have somebody come back and then they come back eventually, it's full duty, but part of their medical is that they're supposed to use medical marijuana and they're a driver. Are they going to lose their job? Because now you've got that conflict. And I know that would be an issue with bus drivers, I'm bus drivers with you guys probably, and bus drivers with the school. So what happens to those people? Because now that their medical ailment entails that this doctor is, you know, instead, well, do we want them to smoke the pot or opiates? I mean, I'm being sarcastic, but I mean, that's what happens.
That's a good question.
Yeah, you know, so because that happens. Because that's your choices anymore. You know, and I sure as heck wouldn't want to, when I had my surgery, you know.
Yeah, I do think our policy on medical marijuana and the federal laws and state laws are clear. So if you, police officer, if you get injured, you're on light duty and say, okay, I came back, I can get back to full duty, but I need my medical marijuana. The state will not give you a police officer certification. So that's the state saying, no. If you're driving a commercial vehicle, that's regulated by the federal government. If you're driving a commercial vehicle with passengers, that's HTA.
What about heavy equipment or machinery at like the sewage plant or something if they're operating?
There's a good law on that.
Here's another question.
There could be an OSHA law where it says you can't operate. That'd be a very specific one. I have to think about it.
So, hypothetically speaking, let's say somebody gets hurt on the job and it messes them up, again, they have to give that an alley. You're saying they can't beat that job. Is there any contingency that they can be placed into another job that they're qualified for that we're just going to come loose due to their injury? That's about, I don't know.
Yes, so the policy that we have right here, if you're unable to return from the essential functions of their position, it may result in demotion, dismissal, or transfer to a classification which the employee is qualified and is able to perform the essential functions with or without reasonable suspicion.
Okay.
I was just curious
about that. But that position has to be open,
right.
So on. I mean, it's just
right.
Standard. Well, you can stay out on disability or light duty for a long period to try and recuperate back to your old situation. If it's at such a point you're not, then you actually can say,
right,
for the most part.
Thank you. One final thing?
Yeah, of course.
So we're kind of focusing on medical marijuana where opioids are even worse. Does the drug policy, whatever have a thing about opioids, because I know people out there working and they're popping Tylenol 3s or whatever they can get their hands on because their pain is, but they get them through it, so.
The drug tests, at least for the bus drivers and commercial drivers, it was recently updated to include opiates and opioids, so there is that clause. I don't know off the top of my head for police officers. But yeah, I'm not saying that one is better or worse. So you guys happy with
yep.
that?
Yeah.
You guys are just asking for a friend that's a switch.
No, I mean in this day and age, it's kind of scary because, I mean, personally, if somebody had medical marijuana growing in your own, it's an opiate, you know, because they're just so, opiates are just so debilitating, you know, and that's what's scary. So.
Dana, Mayor? Dana.
Well, certain jobs are fully drug-free, in my fellow.
Yeah.
Right.
So. You should be.
So next we have the probation policy. I had a couple of typos in here. I cleaned those up. So Ken, I think you mentioned last time that only the newly hired police officers, EMTs, and paramedics should get 12 months probation, and the internally promoted public safety officers will get the standard 6. So I added that in bullets.
Okay, this one's just reading. Yep.
Is there a contingency, like any temporary appointment, emergency appointment in 6 months? What if I don't really know how it works, but a grant writer, you get a grant writer, what if it takes longer than 6 months? Or anybody that you temporary hire, emergency appointment stuff, if it goes, you know, it's kind of a...
Do another one? And what if you can't fill a position?
Yeah, you know, that's more like an operational question, I guess. If we have a grant for 6 months and they can't deliver, then the funding will stop. Yeah. But depending on who it came from, they may want some money back. We couldn't do it.
Most grant writers and stuff like that aren't necessarily hired by the city. They're contracted out.
Oh, okay.
And so many jobs are contracted out, but these are mainly to fill in situations that maybe one of the employees got injured and he's on light duty and you need somebody to fill that position. So there isn't another person to move up in the line because we're running so short-handed, so they'll hire somebody off the street. A big one, of course, like you said, is dispatch, because you could bring somebody in while you train somebody new to take it full-time. I would think after 6 months, you'd have to go back out and re-advertise for another 6 months, is what you'd have to do.
What normally happens is, we'll have a vacancy. I'll use the dispatch example. We'll post it, and it's going to take 2 months, 6 weeks to get someone in, and then 6 to 8 weeks training. But because we're able to find trained dispatchers already, we can hire them as an emergency hire within 1 or 2 weeks. And we can say, okay, we got you an emergency hire, can't exceed 6 months. If you want to work with us, we've got your application, you're going to take the test and get interviewed just like everybody else, and then you go through that process just like every other candidate. And then if you're selected, then you can be an actual, go through probation, become a real employee, or a regular employee.
So that's an emergency hire versus just a temp?
Yes. Temp is still not to exceed 6 months.
Yeah.
Okay.
But a temp is, what I think of is like a city clerk's office, they brought in a younger lady to get them caught up with a bunch of the paperwork. They were behind Ashley's daughter, actually. We'll go on that later. And then, that type of situation,
they just need to have temporary help for a very short time. They should never really succeed 6 months. If you've got to bring somebody in longer than 6 months of this job, then you either look at emergency or you go out and post it. And so I think there's a fair reason there that somebody could protest that they kept rehiring somebody temporary. That would not wouldn't fly at all.
Okay.
So, yeah, I cleaned that one up. I appreciate that. It looks good to me.
Next, we have the alternative appointments. So, we're getting the temp emergency seasonal acting. Can we find my notes? Okay, so this one there was
lots of
little typos, but I think I cleaned those up. Section D, I made sure that acting employments, they said that's a 5% minimum pay adjustment. And then the employee in the 5% is also an interim. And the employee council recommended that interim appointments not exceed 12 months.
That makes sense. Well, it'd be like Dwayne taking over something in public works, you should be able to hire somebody for that within 12 months.
Yeah, it puts the impetus on HR to get this position filled.
Okay, 90 days, you know.
There you go.
No.
And, so this one, there's section 7 and section 8, and then when you go to the next two pages, you can say, I've eliminated the entire section 7 because previously we only had a thing called a temporary appointment, and everything was being done under the banner of that. And then when we go to section 8, you can see I removed some of the redundant language.
Actually put temporary appointment under A.
Yes. In that one, no, you're right, I'm sorry.
What happens if an employee doesn't want to be alternatively appointed or a temporary assignment given to them? I didn't see a rebuttal on, do they have to accept it?
I don't think there's language that says it is
mandatory
or that they have the right to. I don't know, remember that case? I guess I usually see people chopping at the bit for an interim appointment. Because it's usually promotion, maybe?
And it's increase in salary.
Yeah.
But what happens if somebody in finance doesn't want to be a secretary in another department? I know Arizona's a right-to-work state, but at the same time, you know, you have a great person in finance, and to lose them because they didn't want to do that new job, this seems kind of
mean. I mean, I guess it's hard for me because I say, yeah, I'd never do that. Mm-hmm. You know, if someone doesn't want to do it, why push them out the door? Mm-hmm. But I guess, does that need to be codified?
There should be any kind of like, you're fired because you didn't do it, or
I can put something under interim appointments. You know, interim appointments shall not be mandatory.
Something like that. Yeah.
An employee with, you know, reserve the right to turn down.
I like the reserve the right.
Let's put.
Because there are people sometimes that don't meet that responsibility.
Yeah.
Sometimes even though there is money.
And then you lose them completely.
Right. I like your job.
Okay, so, and on point of time, the mandatory place. So the rates that pop out of not or not. Volunteer policy, I know you guys, the one concern I had noted was about allowing employees to volunteer as well. I'm okay with it because it has the clause about outside of the employee's normal work duties and outside of normal scheduled working hours, and the employee council was okay with that.
Yeah, I still question it because I went in to look at it, and under every job description that the employees have, almost every last sentence is, and has other duties assigned. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like, okay, any employee could be assigned to do anything in the city as part of, you know. So is that truly, you know. But I looked up into the federal and the other state laws, and there's nothing there saying that as long as it's not, you know, if these rules not rehearsed or put down because of it, and that it is outside of normal activities, that's, you know, so, but I just know employees feel sometimes that they're asked to do more than, you know, they're already putting in a 40-hour work week, they got kids, they got other duties, and they said, well, can you come in and, go run the art auction for this weekend or something, and you know, they feel like, well, if I don't, then that's going to look bad on my head.
It's generally not around events. So, that's when it's the issue. You know, Blue Festival of Lights, we need 47,000 people. So, and I just use that as so,
and I guess I feel comfortable with it because we've started, this policy says you need to apply to volunteer to HR. HR has to see if we need a background check, like people for the library annex. And then, because I have internal procedures to accept volunteers now, so I get the application. They say, okay, is this position need a background check? Yes or no. Then they do the paperwork, emergency contacts, they get a file. Then I go to the department director and go, okay, this person can now volunteer. They get a welcome letter that says what their duties are gonna be as volunteers. So in that sense, I would accept an employee that wants to volunteer somewhere for the city through those procedures. So I feel comfortable because of what I put in place, but on the same side, if I hear that managers are making employees work late for events that are not exempt and not compensating, that's an FLSA violation to me, not even the volunteers.
So under this policy, if an employee wanted or was asked to volunteer, they would have to fill out and say, volunteering, they can't just be asked by their supervisor to show up on Saturday?
Absolutely.
Okay, I didn't quite get that as employees follow the same rules as any other, all, you know, outside. You know, I didn't get that out of this, and so I guess that was, I feel comfortable that that's really the policy, that the employee says, yeah, I want to work the chop, something like that, and so they fill out a volunteer form and be just like any other person off the street, versus their boss saying, boy, we need you here this weekend to help utilize this. That's the back and forth, so. Okay, I don't know, I'm okay at this point. If it gets abused, it will become a city council issue.
So each job then has its own job description situation. So like Queen Mine Tour, you would know that you have to have CPR and first aid, and that you have to go to prison worker training, and all of those things are listed individually for each job that
volunteers. Yes, we don't necessarily have job classifications for volunteers. What happens is, I started doing this because it's a good practice, even though this policy isn't approved yet. For example, we've got 20 volunteers at the San Jose Annex. So for each of those, I accept the application from Jason there. I go, okay, Jason, because it's a library position, I have to run the background checks. We do that. And then I have the emergency contacts. chief to volunteer fills out the end of some signature pages about knowing our rules and regulations, what applies, drug-free workplace, mm-hmm. even though you're a volunteer. And then after all that, I give them a welcome letter that says, welcome to the volunteer, blah, 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 you'll be working in the San Jose. Yeah, next year, duties will include, you know, shelving, helping, programming, and your primary point of contact is Jason. Mm-hmm. And he'll set up your schedule and goal and expectations.
Okay.
So there's a couple of them at the police department right now. I know,
yeah.
That then you would also have to say, you know, things that are not to be disseminated outside of public area.
Confidential.
Yeah.
So any volunteer that has any contact with children definitely has to go through referential, right?
Yes. So right now, in the hiring contingencies one, I included the language that wrapped volunteers into that as well. Because right now, technically, there's nothing saying they do background checks. I mean, frankly, I do it if they're working at the library, but it's not really specific.
The city needs all the help they can get, so we don't want to make it so egregious that we don't get the volunteers to step up, but yet we also want to protect the name of the city. Who has it?
So those are the policies that you have already observed. It sounds like you're happy with the changes that I made in response to your comments and what the Board of Council recommended.
Just the one change, really major.
The interim appointments that happened. So we make a recommendation, you know, put in the motion the legalized changes. The next four, I didn't get to you prior. But because this is one recommendation, if you'd like, you can still include these in your recommendation. They don't need to be put out to the public 1 week, and so you guys can use some of them. So the first one, harassment policy. I'm just trying to go bit by bit and clean things up. What you'll see there is instead of being the sexual harassment policy, it's
all including your harassment.
Yes. So we still have all the language about sexual harassment. I just added harassment in general. Verbal, nonverbal, you know, offensive, unwelcoming comments about origin, race, color, that type of thing. Hostility, and so I just expanded it. And I included, you know, who you can report it to, so that could be personnel director, any director, or city manager. And it's just some information about the complaints. It's very difficult for us as a city about confidentiality because almost any report is subject to public records requests. You know, most times we can redact the victim's name, but for example, if there's an accused person, even before then, if it's true or not, that is subject to Freedom of Information Act. So, when you're doing these type of investigations, you know, it's usually revealed to the parties involved during the investigation, unfortunately. Only if necessary, but small city, and if something happens between two people, I mean, I hear a lot of emails as confidential. That's what government agency, you know? And I don't want to deter people, but I don't want to lie to lie. And then I included something about retaliation as well.
So you would report it to your first direct supervisor. You have in the volunteer form that there could be a volunteer that is established as the head volunteer person. There's no, I didn't see, if I reported to my volunteer supervisor and I don't like her answer, then I don't see like a chain of command
for complaint
or an appeal process.
For complaint intake, I don't think you should have to use your chain of command. And I did add, you
can
report.
So you can go right to the top?
Yeah, I put, you can report any such circumstances to the personnel director, any department director, or the city manager.
Okay. So no chain of command is necessary?
No. Okay. Correct. And you don't really have to report to your supervisor. Maybe their supervisor's
knows of it and is not taking actions against it, so.
Right.
You've got the ability to go right to the top, which is the city manager, or whatever.
Okay.
I like this because it isn't just sexual nature only, but also hostile working environment.
Covers it all.
Yeah, which does all that. So, I really don't have any problem with this. You pulled a lot of language off of other ones.
There's no plagiarism in both.
Right.
You know, there's some cities that I think are pretty squared away, so I'll.
Sure. Well, absolutely. That's what I do.
Teaching them. We always go to whatever else is doing.
See what works in your city.
So the order might not be the best thing here, but the next I have nepotism update.
That's right.
So I went through this, and we were missing a little bit. And on a second reread of this, I realized it's only about conflict of interest. There's nothing about family members with the supervisor-subordinate relationship. It's only about family members and procurement and that type of thing. So I added B, which talks about you can't have a familial relationship that has any administrative or operational authority. Cause a conflict of interest or the appearance of, and then it still has, the city will attempt to find a suitable position to which one of the affected employees may transfer. And if that's not nature, then the employees will have to determine if one of them will resign. And I think that's mostly, the scene, several places I added the word acquire. So if two people get acquired, marry your boss, we'll try to transfer somebody, but.
Okay, we already have people in this situation working in the city, right?
There are some, and the employee.
Are they grandfathered?
We talked about dispatchers. There's dispatchers married to a police officer, and I didn't have an issue with that because I don't think they have any authority with them. I mean, they can work together, but they're not one's boss.
It would be if it was a chief of police.
Yeah, exactly.
So what about summer hire? We had this issue years back because when Russ was here, his daughter was my head lifeguard. So my boss, who at the time was Carolyn Gonzalez, she would supervise Russ's daughter. I would supervise her daughter so the kids could still lifeguard. I mean, we shifted.
I don't know the names.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay, so Caroline ran Parks and Rec.
Okay.
Russ was Public Works, and I was running the pool. And their kids, and my niece, so my niece was there, Carolyn's daughter was a lifeguard, and then Russ's daughter. So we all just shifted who was in charge of who to get over the nepotism. I was in charge of Carolyn, Carolyn's was in charge of Russ, and Russ was in charge of my niece.
I'm okay with that, and in certain circumstances, like in the police department, I'd be okay with a shift change. You marry, you get promoted to sergeant, okay, guys can advance the shift. I think that's a common policy.
So the one thing I was thinking when I read this was that any administrative or operational authority, well, any administrative isn't like your immediate supervisor. It could be two levels up. So, in a small organization like this, that could cut out a lot of people. I mean, so I want to get a balance, but then on the other side.
What about a council liaison and the son in the same?
Council liaison is not an employee, so it doesn't have an administrative. Yeah, as a council person, you have no administrative authority over anybody. Mm-hmm. You can only everybody, they all have to report to the city manager. The city manager does it.
And state statute has it specifically worded as to how many, when it becomes effective, if it's 10 or more in the organization, then it's not just the one.
So we have no cases then at this time of nepotism?
No, I don't have anything about grandfathering, but there's no situations that I know
that
which would automatically trigger this.
Yeah.
Just a small town, is it?
I wish there was another word. Wish there was another word besides administrative and operational authority. What do you mean by operational authority? In other words, to me, it's all administrative, not necessarily operational.
Yeah, I I would say, you know, administrative is maybe doing the schedule and operational would be a police sergeant, police officer. And we could just say any authority over the other person or that the back to say have any operational authority.
Well, see, operational to me, at least in where I came from out of the fire department, was unless you have the right to give days off and discipline and do whatever, you really don't have necessarily an overview of that employee. So a fire captain can put a letter in somebody's file, but he can not give days off. He can't. It has to be a battalion chief or above. That's when it becomes administrative. The fire chief or the lieutenant or the fire captain that has operational, but he doesn't get to give it raises. He doesn't do, you know, he just tells him, okay, go do this. You need to go do that. I guess that's why I'm a little confused, because that's very broad brush, is both administrative and operational. That pretty well encompasses almost anybody with in the hierarchy above them.
Maybe we can say direct supervisory.
Yes,
only supervisory,
or department heads, or something somebody that has the right to be able to discipline. Mm-hmm. So in other words, has disciplinary action. A sergeant can't discipline a police officer. He has to go to the chief to do it.
Maybe you say, you know, first line supervision. So it's only your boss.
Yeah, I mean, to me, a sergeant may be able to chew out of one of his guys because he has his authority over him, but he's not going to say, well, you don't come to work tomorrow, or mm-hmm. I'm going to put a letter in your file, I'm going to do whatever. Then he has to go to above him, to the chief that actually has that authority. That's the kind of authority I think should be that person could really do something nepotism-wise, favoritism, giving promotions.
So because
operational doesn't give promotions, yeah, generally.
So maybe no first or second line supervision?
I don't know the right words. I struggle with this. I just don't like operational, because operational.
It's a training guy. Or even like you said, the direct supervisory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
clearer. Give it some thought. I'm just operational to me makes the brush a little bit too broad. You know,
I'd be happy with just direct supervisory authority.
That to me makes it a little clearer to me. So that's, I don't know how everybody else feels.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Good point.
San Francisco shall not have any direct supervisory authority over the other person.
Right.
Okay.
I mean, it could be a wastewater two person and a wastewater one, and he has operational okay over the top, yeah, over the one, but
not the person.
Not this, anyway, we don't want to. We'll leave that one. Okay.
Okay. So now we're on that PTO cash out.
That's my last question. Go ahead.
So I put this one together, and we wanted to kind of encourage it, but put some restrictions on it. So first, that you must have a certain minimum hours remaining after cash out. We want employees to clearly cash out all their PTO. And then we also want the restrictions so that in the previous 12 months you've actually used some PTO as well. So we're kind of trying to get you to use PTO as well, because then some people just work themselves to death. Working with the fire department employee council, you know, they made the suggestions for the time frames for the fire department employees. And the one thing that the employee council, there are two versions of this. The first one I wrote said it was, the PTO cash out for employees shall be determined by city manager or city council in completing the annual budget. So every year they would decide, are we going to do this and how much? But I didn't have a minimum in there, and the employee council said, okay, we should have a minimum, so no matter what, we can get 40 hours. And anything over that is determined at budget time, but it should be 40 hours minimum. I have mixed feelings about this.
So
I'm okay with it being determined every year at budget time. So if you have a Or if we're going to do this, are we going to go all in and say everybody's 40 hours, that's that?
So let me give you my background from years on the council. This came up many, many years ago. A little history. And it was brought up by the auditor. And the auditor said, you cannot, because PTO that is accumulated is a liability to the city. So you have to have a set amount so that you know what we know what the liability. And so again, you can't build it. That was the user lose. If you start to pay out, we have no idea how much that will be. And in a budget time, how do you budget it? Because one, you don't know if the person's going to be not taking sick leave and coming in sick, so they don't have to take their PTO. They're going to take 40 hours to meet this, but then after that, they'll just flat not, you know, take any more. You know, sometimes employees can. So the auditors looked at it, and I don't know if you've read this by the finance director, but that was why we decided we couldn't do this, because there's no way of budgeting an unknown number. It's an unknown number. You've got 80 employees, and then do some departments get the budget and some don't? Where's the fairness in?
So it would, I agree.
Okay.
But I did look at numbers, and you can at least put a maximum to it. So with the payroll spreadsheet, for lack of an analogy, you're kind of adding, going from 52 weeks a year to 53 in what you're paying, because it's still subject to payroll taxes. So we can at least get a maximum number. So we have 75 full-time employees at a certain hourly rate. We're adding, so instead of a 2,080-hour work year, there's two extra 40. So you can, yes, you can push it to maximum, but you're right, we don't know exactly what it'll be.
And that was the problem with the auditors. If you can't budget a real number, I mean, of course we all guess, but you can max them up. If there's 8 people in the department and they all earn this, it's an easy spreadsheet. 40 hours for this person is this much, 40 hours for this, blah, blah, you know. For the fire, 72 hours for this many people. You build that in the budget, then if it doesn't get used, is that really the best budgeting method? Is you budget for it, but yet it doesn't.
It could lead to, I guess, you know, over budgeting.
Well, it is over budgeting, and then sometimes what happens under budgets, and this is what the auditor brought up, as we all know, it's all a matter of staying under that final number. So if your people aren't taking all that, well, you just use it somewhere else and you just transfer in your budget and say, okay, well, I need more tasers, so I'm going to buy some tasers because the guys aren't taking their PTO. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or we ran over on our overtime, so we're going to use this extra funds that is not being spent into the overtime budget. So it's kind of a wibbly worm, and that's why I think it needs. I think this should be held and discussed overall with the finance director, with the auditors, find out exactly what that the city manager. I know employees are comfortable with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I hate to be the guy here beating up on the employees.
You have to pay for lunch that day.
So, but I don't know if it's ready to go before council without some of these other. I just know way back when, and it was one of the first 2 years I was on, the auditor hit us with not having the liability listed in our PTO as a liability in the budget. That was an auditor finding, I don't remember. So I looked at that and thought, this is coming back again, but has it
been? It's the regular wage, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
See, and the schools got hit with that years ago. They used to pay us our X amount per sick that we didn't use like when you quit, and now it's like $25 per day.
Yeah, I have to check
I even dropped it because we used to be like $100.
Yeah, I have to check the law on that because like PTO is yours and it's a full liability, but sick leave technically is not. So if an organization chooses to allow you to cash it out at retirement, they can put a caveat on that? I don't know.
Well, my department, I accumulated my vacation time up to a certain amount, and that was that was cut just like this. Sick leave we accumulate forever, okay? But payout was 50%.
Yeah.
So that's how it worked. I had 2,800 hours of sick leave and after when I retired. And so I got 1,400 hours worth of pay and bought me my new truck. But
you see, the state of Arizona, Mark, when he retired there, they only pay so much per year. We have like 4 years that we'll get a check in December until it's all caught up or paid out.
Well, they don't give you one time.
No, yeah.
Well, that's how they can budget it out and not have big, huge hours with them do that.
Now, so, can people transfer their PTO to another person?
We don't have a sick leave bank or donation policy, but that's one of the things that they want, the employees want to.
And I think you should have that.
Yeah,
I
do too.
We had that and it was easy. I'll give them 6 hours of my sick leave. And,
right.
It helps people that can't come back under light duty, but run out of their PTO.
Exactly. Ours is we have to work a year and then we can commit.
Yeah, there's a lot of different models, yeah. So that'd be a huge camera. Some places you can give yours directly to one person.
My only suggestion is just make sure this I'm okay for the employee side of it, but I just want to make sure that the city manager and the finance director is checking out with their auditor and see if this would cause any kinds of problems in the budgeting process. And the mayor and council needs to be brought on board and saying, this is your responsibility budgeting. How are we going to budget this? You know, is we're going to budget max every time? Is that a good budgeting process? Or what? And we can't very well just budget it for the police and the fire or not for wastewater, but we can for somebody else.
Well, I don't know if I could afford that differently, but it'd be equally for every time. Mm-hmm.
So that's my
good.
Okay. That's all.
All right. So we can hold that one over the finance. Last one is a whistleblower policy statement that would go up front along with our other policies and statements about harassment.
That's good to me.
Seems pretty strong that if somebody says something, they'll have to fear that they'll be retaliated in some way. I'm just double checking. Mm-hmm. Something that retaliation will not be tolerated, and any retaliation could cause actions against that person or something like that. Something that would put a bite on the fact that, you know, you may not like what this person said, and if you start doing something, now you're the one in trouble. So I don't know if that's in here.
It's not. It just says, I think.
Yeah.
I think that's a violation of this policy.
So the only one I was to be given it on both sides. I always like to complicate that. it's fine if it's written. If somebody starts to retaliate, then I would expect the city to take some sort of action against that person. Say knock it off. Don't, then you're going to be disciplined. All right, well, that was an hour, a little. So, any other comments?
I just
and I think,
commend everyone. everybody, I think it's a job well done, but, you know, it needed updated.
It was a big chunk all at once, I have to admit. I hope they come in smaller chunks next time.
Yeah, I was talking to the city manager, I'm like, can we piecemeal this, or just...
Go for it, huh?
Yeah.
I mean, now I'm thinking of the board, maybe the council, it's gotta go through this.
I know what you guys want.
We spent hours doing it, you know? And so, anyway, that, they gotta...
They might have a half a work session.
Well, the thing of it is, I hope they rely on their employee and civil service commission to think they've done some work on it, so hopefully...
And I'd like to applaud on the members on this commission for doing your homework over the last month. It went a lot smoother and quicker than it could have.
So what I'd like is, do you think, I'd like a motion that we go ahead and send, majority of this up to mayor and council as we revised, with the one caveat of the PTO that it be passed by the finance director. It's outside of our purview. I mean, as far as it's written, it's fine, but we think it would be a good idea to...
Can we say it's just A through J and L?
Yeah, that would work. So.
You made the motion, I'll second.
Okay, I'd like a motion that we approve this update and we send them on to mayor and council for their consideration. Items A through
J
and L.
Second.
All those, we have a motion and a second on the floor. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So moved. Number five, we'll be in the order. Anybody have any?
Kathy and I are looking at going to the employee council meeting on February the 13th at 10 a.m., correct? We looked at the agendas and we thought that's when it was coming up.
I haven't.
Oh, we'll look again and verify.
I haven't done the agenda for it yet, so.
Would you let us know and put that in an email with us, so it was February then?
I think the 13th at 10 a.m., and that would be at Torreyville, is that where that would be?
All of them would be.
You have to check with
the senior center.
And check the council.
Only the council, and then the board of the planning and zoning and the DRB will be at the senior center, because I expect people will show up. Most of these other ones won't be. February 13th, they just had a meeting, didn't they? Not long ago.
January 9th.
I think it was
special meetings.
Oh,
yeah.
To consider this stuff. So their normal one is February, okay. That makes sense. Okay. Yeah, if you'd include us in on that, so, because I have talked also to some of the employees, and they said, might hurt for us to understand a little more what they're doing, and then eventually maybe we can meet up as a work session together.
Perfect.
Great comment. Anything else? Local staff report, or is there?
Just a couple items to kind of let you know what I'm up to. This policy is one of the big projects I'm working on. The other one is health insurance through the Cochise Combined Trust.
Mm-hmm.
That's a decision I'd have to go to council, but they have accepted us if we so choose. And the rates are competitive. There's really two parts to the rates. The total rates for the health insurance plan is they're much more competitive for us, but it comes at the cost of your joining a trust. There's a 3-year minimum, and it's a commitment, and the city council would have to approve that and then appoint two people from the city to be on the board of that trust. But it also gives us local control over our benefits. So the members on that board would go through how much we're spending, and if we want to adjust a copay here, or expand or change that, the board can make that decision.
Does that board also set the rates?
Yes.
So it's kind of like a retirement board. And you got to be careful if you don't get somebody on there that, you know.
Yeah, so it depends how many organizations join.
Right,
right now it's Cochise County and Cochise College. And if we join, we'd be the third organization, so each body would send two.
Mm.
But then if the fourth joins, it would go down to each body sends one.
And how long did you say? 30 2 years?
Three. So if you join, you can't join for 1 year.
Years.
I loved it.
And the other issue with health insurance rates that I kind of, we're not matching a lot of our competitors in the area because we pay a flat rate. So what happens is if you have a family, your spouse, or child, they're not paying a lot. What we do is we pay what the employee rate is. It's usually about 500, and it's flat across the board. However, everybody looking at around here, Douglas, you know, Wilcox, Benson, Sierra Vista, the county, it's tiered, so it's a percentage. So the city pays a percentage of your.
So you have individual, you have you and your wife, or you have a family. It's usually a three.
Correct.
Three.
And you can have where you don't pay anything, or you can get the premium, and that's like a one. I pay extra. Mm-hmm. If I didn't choose to have the top grade, I'd have the regular middle line, and I wouldn't have to pay anything. But I pay top grade and our tier, and it's not that much more a month, but then I bring my daughter up too.
And
that's
right. And right now, if a family plan is about a minimum like $840 a month.
Yeah.
And that's because we don't have a tiered percentage here. We just say everybody is the same. So I was able to get the numbers for a lot of the other cities down to the counties, and we're the ones doing that.
It's really prohibitive on family or city.
Yeah.
I really like that.
So that, aside from the trust, that's going to be one of my big budget requests to make a change to a more tiered and fair approach. So you guys, a couple of days, what I'm working on, we have a new vendor for background checks that I'm pretty happy with. Redoing all the employment volunteer applications and the disclosures for background checks. So it's in line with, I'd say, best practices where we're doing it the correct way. What else? And there's always a lot going on. Those are some of the biggest things. As we're going to budget out, hopefully maybe get some applicant tracking software so we can take applications online. So you can still take a hard copy, but you can also apply online, and I can go in and say, okay, you know, these applications are moving forward to the next round, and I'll send the notifications to everybody else. I'd like to get one of those. We're kind of behind, but we do get a lot of online paper applications. So I want to kind of meet the needs of the local people. Is how they're used to applying, but I still want to grow. So.
Well, all you do is get those right now. You don't have an online way. So
there is an online
is
way,
there?
But it's just data entry and just emails it to me.
Oh.
But you can get software like Neogo, and I'll say, okay, I can click account clerk, and I'll have my 10 applications. And then I can send those to the finance director and say, rate these, that type of thing. And then, you know, who moves to the next stage? It'll do the notifications automatically. You can book interview times online.
You could have sourced it right per job. Instead of you're getting 15 applications.
And it just goes in an inbox that I can print.
Right.
So I'm going to ask for some money for that, but I'm going to ask for it all. I'm trying to think. I didn't have a staff report, but I'm
the only other part I would think maybe I'd like to discuss in our next meeting would be job descriptions and how, you know, it's been a courtesy for us to look those over and talk about them. I think that's something that we should work with the employee council on. I know it's deep in their heart about, I mean, that's their job, and so what kind of overview and what would recommendations would we want to take forward to council to possibly change the idea of overseeing job descriptions?
So I will say with our job descriptions, we do have a lot of work to update them. Some of them are pretty old. The pay bands we use, the last time council updated was 2005, and it's just, they're atrocious. There's 70 pay bands, and 25 of them are below minimum wage. So we're way behind. We need to do that. So hopefully we can get working with a classification compensation study where we can kind of get a consultant here, work with me, and we can kind of redo all the job descriptions because we're missing a lot. For example, let's give an example of my groundskeeper, Tom Cole, great guy, he retired, he goes, Dan, I'm the lead groundskeeper, I don't have an operational such thing. And then he left and someone was, are you gonna promote for the lead? I go, so it's one on duty work.
I mean, as far as compensation, there's a League of Cities and Towns. And
yeah, I have their studies.
Yeah, I've, you know, I used to get that all the time and really realize where we were. And so, anyway, that's some of the stuff I have.
Can I touch on that too as well?
Sure.
The compensation, I know, Joni, we talked about it, and I said I couldn't give it to you because they emailed their Excel file that they didn't want, but I didn't have the PDF. So do you want me to email that to you guys if you care?
Sure.
I used to get it as a council member because I was on the with, I just had to get a hold of the league and just say send me your rate thing for you.
As far as the job descriptions, you know, whatever you guys in council decide, it's really weird for me to even take them to council, and I mean that like respectfully. Normally that's just like an HR function. We need a task to do this, and HR is okay, you know, here's your minimum qualifications, the education you need, and the tasks they're gonna do. And I've worked at a couple other cities, and I've never had to take something such minutia to council. I feel like this is like a city administrator. You know what I mean? If you guys want it, you got it. But I'm gonna say, you can improve my timesheet too, you know, it's a little much.
I think the reason it's brought before council is because it's kind of been known to see the light of day, because it becomes a public record and it isn't just done administratively behind. So, you know, and generally I've never known a job description to get turned down some questions, but never been turned down. I guess our only thing my thing would be we and the employee council could work together so that when they move up to council, they have our blessing, and that should give them a lot more okay. That, you know, it's just like these. They've been brought before employee council twice, us twice, blah blah blah, mm-hmm. And that can be said. And so I'm hoping that will be a good thing for the mayor and council. So,
what are we supposed to do? Do I get to say that? Do I get to think that I'm supposed to be the liaison? I allow this
people? Sure, you just can't vote.
Okay, that's why I just want to clarify. Because after I spoke, I thought.
Well, I mean, there's another weird one. It's called, you'd have to be named ex officio, because you could be an ex officio because you were on this before.
Right.
The mayor would have to make that motion for you. But it's really up to the chair. I mean, all the liaisons that I've been around, lots of times don't let things roll, but when this small a group, it's not a bad idea to, because it's your job to take it back now to council and say, I was here, I participated in it, and so on and so on.
I just wasn't sure.
All right, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye, so move. Adjournment at 5:57.
Six. That thing's thrown me
up. I
know,
it's messed up.
An hour long.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you guys for coming in. I know I've been keeping you busy the last few months.
So next week's council meeting is at the senior center. I'll come driving out here all on autopilot.
Thank you.
Thanks. See you later.
Bye.